Okay, if you could, if you all could take your seats, we'll get started here. Well, I'd really like to thank Ron and the music team this morning. They did a fantastic job, and I just can't, as I was listening, I didn't know what songs they were going to sing other than Victory in Jesus, but it just fit in just perfectly with today's sermon, and I think as you'll go along, you'll appreciate some of what they did, and thank you for your hard work there this morning, guys, and appreciate that. We're going to continue on in a series that we've been doing in the month of December, and we're using the acronym LOVE, L-O-V-E, and 2 weeks ago, Eric talked on, I think it was love and life, and last week, Dan talked on, where's Dan? He's back there. He talked on obedience, love and obedience, which are closely tied together. And today we come to the letter V. And when you think of the letter V, what do you talk about with the letter V? It's difficult to find something. The very first thing that popped into my mind, and somebody else said the same thing, is victory. Abby back there, yeah, you said victory. So we're going to talk about victory in Jesus this morning. And seeing as how on this Friday is Christmas Day, and we're going to be celebrating the birth of Christ, the baby Jesus on this Friday, I'd like to take victory and somehow tie it with the Christmas story. So that's what we're doing this morning, kind of trying to tie those two together. And I know all the kids out here were really looking forward to it. We want a little bit of that Christmas story in there. And I think adults too would like to see that. So we're going to attempt to do that this morning. What does it mean, victory or victorious? Well, it's actually a pretty simple definition. It means simply to defeat the enemy in battle or a game. To defeat the enemy, to win. That's victorious. It's pretty simple. And I think it's easy to understand. Well, we're going to be talking about victory in Jesus a little bit more and the song that we sang earlier entitled Victory in Jesus. But one other thing is that if you have your bulletins, inside your bulletin is some sermon notes. And if you didn't get the sermon notes and would like to have one, they're kind of handy to look at. You can kind of doodle on them as we're going up here, take notes. You've got that. If you don't have that and you want that, raise your hand and the usher will get that to you this morning. So very handy to have. Hey, let's open up in prayer here for this morning. Lord, we do thank you for this morning. Thank you for people that came in this morning. And we also thank you for the audience that's watching from home this morning as well. Pray that you'd move our hearts, Lord. Help us to learn more from your word that we can apply, Lord. And we do thank you right up front, Lord, for the victory we have only in Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to be talking about the wise men this morning, the wise men. And everything that we know about the wise men is in 12 verses. It's only mentioned in the one Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to be reading Matthew chapter 2, 1 through 12 right away here. And as we go through this, I challenge you, what we want to do is we want to magnify the word. And what's that mean? What's magnify? It means that we're going to take a really close look at it. And the word is such that the more you look, the more the richness of the word comes out at you. It's deep. There's things there that you don't observe on the surface. You got to go deeper in. And this story, I think, is like that. There's a lot going on here in these 12 verses. And when we're all done, I got to give you a little heads up here, is that we're going to have a little quiz. And especially you kids out there, I want you to pay close attention because, Joanne, you're laughing. I'm going to call on you. We're going to have a little quiz when it's all done. So you all pay close attention because you have an opportunity to call out the answer to some of these questions that's going to rise from these. So let's go to it here. Matthew 2, 1 through 12, and I'm reading out of the NIV or whatever you have. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews?" I'm going to point out here that some versions use the word Magi, which basically just means wise men. Some versions also have astrologer, I believe, too, as a term for the wise men. We're going to talk about the wise men, though, today. They mean the same thing. Now, to continue, "We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him. Now, when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ or the Messiah was going to be born. And this is their answer. It says, 'In Bethlehem in Judea,' they replied, 'for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be shepherd of my people.'" They're quoting Micah 5:2, by the way, there. "Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and make a careful search for the child. Now, as soon as you find him, report back to me so that I too may go and worship him.' Now, after they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. Now when they saw the star, they were overjoyed." "Now on coming to the house," pay close attention, "on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold, incense, and myrrh." Or some versions will say gold, frankincense, and myrrh, which are the same thing. "And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route." So it's a pretty simple story, just the 12 verses, that's all. That's all we know about the wise men. Everything the Bible says is right here. Simple, simple story. Now, the quiz. You guys ready? Boy, I used to hate that when I was in school and the teacher would get up there and say, "Okay, now get out your papers." You knew what that meant, a quiz. We hated that. And some teachers really rubbed it in. They didn't, you know. Okay, the first question is, now, don't answer this because it's kind of a hard one, and I'll give you a free bonus answer here. How's that? Okay, the first question, who were these wise men? Okay, we're not really sure who they were. This is all we know about them, is that they were called wise men or the Magi, and that they were from the east. Some people have suggested that they were actually royal astrologers from what other country they were from. They were people that observed the sky. And that's possible. You know, we don't know. It's interesting to think about such things, but we really don't know the answer to that one. Okay, the next question. How many wise men were there? If you know the answer, yell it out here. Peter, what's that? What did you say? We don't know. Why don't we know? It doesn't say. Well, how many do you think there were? There might be three, but the Bible doesn't say. It could be two. It could be a dozen. Caleb, what do you got to say? I'm sorry to burst your bubble, guys, but you know, and I've even got to my little three wise men right up here. And, you know, but there might be three, but there might be two, there might be a dozen. We don't know. Okay, where were these wise men from? Who knows that answer? The East. Now, that's all we know, the East. Where is the East? Well, if you're in Jerusalem and you go east, you're going to cross the Jordan River. And Katie was in Israel not too long ago. She probably knows all this really well. Yeah, so if you're in Jerusalem, you get down the hill into the Jordan Valley and you cross the river. And then there's the hills of Gilead over there. And if you keep going, there's a huge desert. It's called the Arabian Desert. And it's an extremely hostile place to cross, very difficult. And if you keep going across that big desert on the other side, you come to where Iraq and Iran is now. And so it's possibly Babylon or something from Persia. Really likely that's where they came from, is one of those areas, and that's been hypothesized. And if that's the case, if that's where they came from, it's an extremely difficult journey. It's not a one-day drive in the car. It's, you know, you cross this desert, there's very little water, there's only a couple watering holes along the way. If you don't make it to the next watering hole, you're dead. Any of you guys ever hiked in the desert before? Adam, I'm sure has, haven't you? Yeah, you have. Yeah, it's dangerous. You know, it's really dangerous. I almost didn't make it. When did this take place? That's the next question. When did the wise men come? When Jesus was what? When Jesus was a toddler. So he was more than a baby. He was not a newborn anymore. And if you read between the lines a little bit, because remember, King Herod wanted to find out exactly when Jesus was born so he could figure this. He's a pretty sharp guy. He wanted to figure this mystery out, you know. Who is this little king that's trying to take over my authority? How am I going to figure out which one is him? And he's smart. Yes, like Peter said, he was probably between 1 and 2 years old at this time. So sorry to say, these guys, you know, we show the wise men right out there in the entry, these guys at our house, that's where these came from. My wife will probably shoot me for bringing these here today. Right, see, I told you. And so they always show them together, but actually, according to the word, they were two separate events here. No big deal. That's not important. Okay, last question. What words would you use to describe King Herod? Yell it out. Liar. Yeah, what else? Insecure, terrified. What's that, Lee? He was terrified of this little baby. Is that what you're saying? Yeah. Jealous. Okay, that's a good one. That's rude. How about ruthless, conniving? Now, we do know more about King Herod because he is also mentioned in history. He was a big historical figure. He was noted for building some tremendous building projects in all over Israel. And Katie, did you hear much about King Herod when you visited? Yeah, you'll go out. They still exist. There's these big stone buildings that Herod was responsible for building all over. Fortresses, and they're still there. You know, he had an impact. He was Herod the Great, and he was a man to be reckoned with. And looking at it, you know, when the people of Jerusalem heard about this king, what does it say? It says the king was disturbed, and so were the people of Jerusalem disturbed when they found this out, because they knew that Herod would not put up with anybody else moving into his territory as a king. That would take away power from him, and he was powerful. So those are the characters we have. Okay, let's look at the story a little bit more here and just kind of dig a little bit deeper. So the wise men arrive in Jerusalem and tell everybody that they're looking for this baby king of the Jews. Now, if you were in Mount Pleasant, somebody came and, let's not say Mount Pleasant, you were in Washington, D.C., the Capitol building, and some people came up to you and made these claims and said, you know, where do we find this baby? You'd say, these people are nuts, you know. Who do they think they are demanding to know where this baby is at? And they'd probably think they're just fruitcakes, you know, people that don't know what they're doing. But on the other hand, look at it, everybody, the king and everybody in Jerusalem in a very short period of time had heard this story. It just went throughout. So what's that say about the wise men? It says that they were believable, reputable. They were ambassadors from another country. They probably looked the part too. You know, these guys here, they got these little crowns on, and they're carrying these little treasure chests. I don't think it was these little treasure chests they had, but that people could look at them and say, these guys are legitimate. They are VIPs. They are people that need to be listened to. They're well-to-do. They may have a lot of gold. A lot of times people will show them with camels. Now, camels back in that day were something your average person did not have. They were for the wealthy people who were traveling. In today's world, you know, if the people came, they would be coming in on limousines. They'd fly in on their personal jets. They'd be brought in with limousines if they were really ambassadors from another country. But in that day and age, they made an impression. And so they were people to be listened to and reckoned to. They were not just, you know, homeless vagabonds. Now, in verse 7, it says the king secretly called these wise men to visit. And if these wise men were in Washington, D.C., and they were telling this story, they would have to be very believable for the king. Let's say the president says, okay, I want to hear more about it. He secretly brought them in. It's very difficult to get an appointment with the president or, say, the Queen of England. We were in Williamsburg, Virginia one year, and the Queen of England just happened to be there at the same time. And the place was just crawling with Secret Service type people. Everywhere you looked, there were these big black SUVs driving around, and everybody, they were looking at you very suspiciously, you know, to make sure the queen was being protected well. But the king invited them in. He said he wanted to learn more about them, and as you can tell, somebody suggested it here. He was kind of a conniver, you know. He wanted to find out what these guys knew, and he wanted to play them. He wanted them to do the work. Figure out, you know, and he did point out that the Christ was to be born in Bethlehem to them, so they knew Bethlehem. And but he was trying to get them to do the work because he wanted to find that baby and that king and bump them off. Don't want any competition. Okay, now here in verse 11, I'm going to point out, when the wise men got to the house where baby Jesus was at and Mary, doesn't say Joseph, but he was there too, we're sure. And it said they did three things. One, they came in and they bowed down to the king. This is the young king, 1 year old, 2 year old. They honored and respected him as king, and so they bowed down, and they did something like this. They bowed down and worshiped the king. And a wise man once told me that he called it, when you honor and respect somebody, you bend your knee to that person. So when you're in royalty or you're coming before the Lord, you bend your knee to them. And it's a sign of honor and respect and acceptance. They respected Jesus as the king, more so than they did King Herod. They worshiped him. Now, worship is something that is for God only. So they recognized that this was God because they worshiped him, it says there. And worship is to draw near. It's a word that means to draw near in order to... technically, it means to draw near in order to like embrace somebody or kiss them, you know, in a very endearing term. And three, they gave gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh to the baby and to the family. And so we don't know how much it was. I think it was probably pretty substantial how much they gave them. But these were treasures that they had brought all the way from, let's call it Babylon, to there. I don't know. And another thing to take note of, we didn't read these verses, but after the wise men left and returned to their own country, what happened after that? Well, King Herod realized the wise men had outsmarted him. So what he did is he was very furious, and he made a declaration that every young boy in Bethlehem was to be murdered. He wanted to make sure he got that guy out of his pasture. He says, okay, I don't know which one it is, so I'm just gonna kill the whole bunch of them to make sure that I get this. And they started to do that. And God had warned Joseph in a dream. He said, hey, this very evening you've got to get out of here and go to Egypt because Herod is trying to kill Jesus. And so they obeyed. Joseph was, like Dan said last week, talking about love and obedience. God said it, he obeyed, and they went. And so the interesting thing is, I was trying to point out here, is that the gold and stuff that the wise men gave them, when they fled to Egypt, this would provide resources for them to live. And actually, they were probably in Egypt for at least a year, maybe 2 years, before they were able to come back. So it supplied a provision. So that gold that came all the way from Babylon to there, to that, was a provision that God supernaturally supplied to them so that they would be able to flee. And so God was sovereign in that situation. Looking at the wise men, why did they call them the wise men? What was wise about them? And there's three things that I observed and was looking at for the wise men that kind of shows the wisdom that they were wise people. And I wrote in my notes here, if you're reading the notes, I said I called it the wisdom test. What's that? So there's these three things I observed about them. One, it's in your notes, is the first thing I observed about them is they believed in the supernatural. You know, they believed that God was the creator of the heavens and the earth, as do many people, I'm sure you guys do here too. Creator of the heaven and earth, which is a supernatural event. It didn't just arise out of nothing. It was created. And it didn't surprise them that God used a star in the sky to bring them to Jerusalem. It didn't surprise them when God spoke to them in a dream, and they listened and they went back to their home in a different way. God gave them a warning in a dream. And so they were people who accepted God in a supernatural sense. The second part of the wisdom test is, I call it treasures. Whoa, don't do that. And treasures means they were faithful. They were faithful with what God had given them to use. They were faithful with what God told them to do. And it means more than just treasures. Yes, they were willing to give of themselves. They're willing to give of their riches, their gold, and their other stuff. But they were willing to take action, you know, on what they knew. God said to go, and they went, you know. That is a sign of wisdom. And the last one is lordship. So when they came before the Lord Jesus, they bent their knee to him and they bowed down and worshiped him. So those three are that show that these guys were very wise. One thing I want to point out, one further thing is here, the difference between the wise men and the religious leaders of Jerusalem. What was different about them? What made the wise men wise and the religious leaders not wise? Well, the religious leaders knew, they could quote Micah 5:2, they knew that the Messiah was going to be born in Bethlehem, and they knew that, and that would be the king, and it says that he would be the shepherd of his people. They knew that. They had, but what I'm pointing out here is that they had a head knowledge of the Messiah. And just so you know, Bethlehem is only a few miles from Jerusalem. It's a one less than a, you know, half a day's walk from there over to Bethlehem. Why didn't the religious leaders, they knew that the Messiah was going to be born there. These guys were looking for him. Why didn't they go too? Where were they in all this? So the difference is they had a head knowledge, but they didn't have a heart knowledge. They knew the information. They knew a lot of stuff, but they weren't applying it. They were not men of faith. They were not men who would put this to their feet. They would not ever bow down to Jesus. I don't know who they bowed down to. Okay. The next session is wise men still seek him. And we're gonna talk a little bit now about how we can use this wisdom test in our own life. And I'm gonna give you my personal story about what happened to me in the year 1976, which has been a couple years ago, and how God spoke to me and he used these wisdom test in my life. And one of the things God spoke to me, you know, that year was kind of a hard year for me. And I had heard about the gospel. I had heard about God. And so part of me was thinking about God. And man, I started reading my Bible and going to church a little bit. And but on the other hand, it says that we have an enemy, and there were some spiritual things going on. I knew that there was a spiritual attack on my life, and the devil was out to get me, and he had his claws in me, and so I was torn. I was torn between. There was a tug of war going on in my life between, do I serve God or do I serve the devil? Do I let the devil run my life? So there was a war. There was a battle going on, and who was going to win? So here's what happened to me, and maybe it's helpful to know this, is if I give myself the wisdom test, and the supernatural. Was I being wise that year? The supernatural. Was I seeing what I? Yes, the supernatural is, I believe, supernaturally there was spiritual warfare going on. But later on, I found out that there was other supernatural things I didn't realize. One is there were a lot of people praying for me. I was not saved, hadn't come to the Lord. Maybe I was a seeker. And it said, remember in Ron, thank you for doing that song. victory in Jesus. And in the chorus, it says that he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. And so I knew that that year that God was pursuing me and he was trying to reveal himself to me. And he did that a couple ways. One, people were praying for me, like I said, but he also put a lot of people in my life that were an influence, that were pointing me to God. And I give him the praise for that. And so that was the supernatural going on at the time. Treasures. Am I willing to use my resources to help others and God? In other words, will I act on what God has shown me to do? And I was reading, like I said, I was reading the scriptures. I knew that I needed to, I didn't know a lot. I didn't have a lot of head knowledge, but I had a little bit of heart knowledge. I knew that God was calling me to himself. He was seeking me. He was trying to redeem me. And so these things were kind of playing on me, and there was that tug of war going on that year particularly. And at Christmas, I'm bringing this up because Christmas is a very special, especially that year was a very special time for me, because that whole year kind of culminated and came to a point at Christmas time in 1976 when I knew a few things that I needed to make a decision on Christ. Was I going to accept Christ and his victory for me, or was I just going to go on living my life and let Satan kick me around and stomp on me and beat me? And I knew a couple of verses. I wrote them down here. I think we're going to have these. It's 1 Peter 5:8. And it says that, be self-controlled and alert, because your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And for some reason, I had remembered that verse. When things were getting tough in my life and I started to realize there was a spiritual battle going on, is for some reason, I remembered that verse from, I don't know, Sunday school or something many, many years ago. That came back to me and I said, hey, somebody's out to get me. There's some bad things happening, and the devil is prowling around like a roaring lion, trying to seek me. Also, John 10:10, it says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. I didn't give that verse to Jeff, so I was just quoting that for you here. So those two were kind of showing where I was at the time. But it all kind of came to a head in December, Christmas time, 1976, when Lordship, I came before the Lord. I encountered the baby Jesus, and what happened was I went out for a walk one night, and I told the Lord that, you know, I didn't know a lot up here, but I wanted to act on what I did know. I wanted to accept what Jesus did as a payment for my sin. I knew that I could not be victorious on my own. I had to accept his victory. His victory was my only hope. And so that night in 1976 at Christmas time, I bent my knee to Jesus and said, hey, your will be done and not my will alone. I want to accept, Jesus, what you did for me and your victory in my life. So at that point, people, I was born again, raised into his family. Now I'm a son of God, and I'm not a son of Satan. You know, there's a crossing over. There's something big that happens at that time. It's not little. It's very, very important. Dan shared a verse. We're going to close up here pretty shortly. Dan shared a verse last week, and it was, credit him with this. It's 1 John 5:3-5. And it says, this is love for God, to obey his commands. And his commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So that's a verse that I call an anchor verse. It's a solid rock piece of truth that you can bet on, you can take to the bank. You know, and what's it say there? This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Our faith is what we trust in. Our faith, if we trusted in Jesus to pay for our sins, have we trusted Jesus to be our Lord and Savior? And that's my challenge for all of us here today, and you in the audience and you at home, is where do you stand with Jesus? By yourself, you are going to lose every time. The only victory that we can have is through the victory that Jesus won for us. We're going to lose. There's a battle going on, and that's important. There's a song I think Jeff's going to play for us right now. And back in that day, there was a young man around, a musician, called Mr. Keith Green. And as a new believer, a lot of my generation, you know, us old fogies, will remember Keith Green. And he died when he was only 28 years old. He was killed. But he had a big impact on me as an early Christian, and a lot of people looked up to him, and he left too early. So this is a song that Keith Green had an impact on me. Jeff, if you could roll that.
Sky, all my hopes would come tumbling down, and I never knew just why, until today when you pulled away the clouds that hung like curtains on my eyes. Well, I've been blind all these wasted years, and I thought I was so wise, but then you took me by surprise. You rolled away the stone that held my heart, and now I see that the answer was as easy as just asking you in. And I am so sure I could never doubt your gentle touch again. It's like the power of the wind, like a fantasy
song says a lot. It says it all. That's how I felt back then. And I think God's love broke through with me in my life. And if you let him, I think he'll do the same. Without love, life makes no sense. And God is love. And we need that love in our lives. What about you this morning? Where are you? Are you a wise man? What about the wisdom test? Does it apply to you? Do you believe in the supernatural in your life? What if God spoke to you in a dream tonight? Would you listen? You'd say, nah, that was just something I ate. Or if you saw a star in the sky, you'd say, man, that's just swamp gas. You know? Exactly, Jeff. UFO, I was thinking that exact same thing. God is sovereign, folks. You know, he's powerful. It shouldn't surprise us if something happens and he wants to speak to you and he wants to tell you something that you can go tell somebody else. You know, you might be surprised. And treasures. If God gives you something, where's your heart at? Does it go into your head and doesn't go into your heart? And I pray that your people that will be people that treasure and you're willing to use what God has given to you to serve other people. And lastly, lordship. You need to bend your knee to the Lord. No other way you can do it. You have to bend your knee to the Lord. You know, it all comes down to that. And hopefully love will break through in your heart. You know, I don't know where you are this morning with the Lord. Maybe there's something that we've said here that's struck something down here. Not just up here, but I'm praying that all our hearts would be affected by this message today. Whether you're a believer or not, I pray that great things would happen as a result of today and this Christmas season. So let's close with that, and we're going to close in prayer. And if you've got more questions on this, please come on up and talk to me afterwards. I'd be glad to pray for you and talk to you and help you along the path I'll give you. But please, take the wisdom test. Take the wisdom test. Lord, we do thank you for this day, Lord, and thank you for the Christmas season. It is wondrous, a joyous season that we can worship and we can praise you for baby Jesus today and pray that our hearts and minds would be filled with wonder, Lord, for what you have done in our lives and what you are going to do coming ahead. And thank you for this, Lord. Thank you for your love and mercy towards us and the great power that you exhibit in each one of our lives. And help us to be today like those people that were an influence on my life. I found out later, after I came to you, I found out that there was a multitude of people who had been praying for me. And Lord, thank you for people like that pray. And I also thank you for the people that were an influence to me before I came to you, who also were people that were responsible, Lord. They're people that treasured. There were people that put in effect to what you said to do. They tried to speak the truth into my heart, Lord. And I thank you for these people that did that were faithful. There were people of faith. Help us to be just exactly like that, Lord, be people of prayer and people of faith in this generation. And we thank you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Take these guys home.